subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Yoga event is held here.
Severe injustice, and they should be stopped.
We should raise our voices.
Condemn this brutal act.
I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. China, which is facing diplomatic heat and a gradual isolation owing to its consistently nefarious designs across the globe, is now working overtime to shift people's attention. It alleged Indian Army of being aggressive along the Ladakh border and said Indians made air fires to assert pressure and threat in Chinese PLA. The Indian Army, which holds a reputation for never intruding an inch in others' territory, has rebuffed the claims and says it was Chinese army involved in misadventure. India says China, which already occupies a significant portion of Indian territory, Aksai Chin, has been consistently endeavouring to alter the status at the border and have grown frustrated following India's preemptive measures that have thwarted their plans.
A growing anti-China sentiment across the globe has baffled Beijing. From the USA to Australia to Vietnam to countries in the South China Sea, everybody has been accusing it of impropriety. While some say it has made illegal intrusions into the sovereign territory, others accuse it of unilaterally breaching trade regulations for its own benefit. Some have even blamed it of being complicit in the spread of the pandemic. And since it has failed to confront them on facts, a new strategy has been devised by the Communist Party of China. The strategy of shifting focus and misleading its own people who are losing confidence in the government. Its periodic misadventures at the Indian border have been re-strategized and escalated into a sustained, prolonged standoff. Since incursions couldn't draw the attention Chinese sought, and assertive Indian forces took firm control of their borders, Chinese recently launched unprovoked firing along the border, first in over four decades.
अभी इंटरनेट और मोबाइल वगैरह नहीं चलने की वजह से अभी हमें बातचीत नहीं हुआ इतना हमें ज़रूर पता हुआ कि रात आज रात को काफ़ी लार्ज सर्कल पे डेढ़ घंटे के तरह डेढ़ घंटा फायरिंग हुआ है एटिलरी फायरिंग हुआ है
आज सुबह 3 बजे वहाँ पे फायरिंग शुरू हुआ तो जिससे पब्लिक में एक डर सा माहौल पैदा हुआ है
While locals testified what transpired at the border, Chinese have come up with an alternate version of the truth in which they say that it was the Indian Army that launched unprovoked firing along the border. While the Indian Army and civilians living along the border say that the firing took place in the wee hours, Chinese statement which didn't clarify on any issue said that their teams were heading for talks.
9月7日 印军非法越线进入中印边境西段班公湖南岸神炮山地域印军在行动中悍然对前出交涉的中国边防部队巡逻人员鸣枪威胁中国边防部队被迫采取应对举措
稳控现地局势。
But who goes for the official talks at 3 a.m. in the morning? Maybe Chinese PLA has a tradition that no country in the world follows or is aware of. Its lies have fallen flat before the world. India, on the other side, maintains that it will continue to protect its borders with full might. It has beefed up its security along the border. Indian troops along the Pangong Lake, the strategic location of the recent standoff, have already secured the vantage points. Recently, New Delhi also inducted French fighter jet Rafale into its forces, a move that experts say has not only widened India's arsenal but will bolster country's war capabilities. Earlier in the week, India had also successfully tested a hypersonic vehicle of 6 times the speed of sound. Its first step towards developing a family of very high cruise missiles.
Now we are joined by foreign affairs expert Dr. Subhra Kamal Datta to speak more on the current standoff between India and China. Dr. Datta, welcome to the show. Amid standoff between India and China at the border, there are efforts to find a solution diplomatically. Foreign ministers of India and China recently met on the sidelines of SCO summit in Moscow. How do you see this development?
To really trust China is a very big question, actually, because whichever nations have trusted China in the past, China has always betrayed those nations. And there are several examples in history where we can cite in such examples. A good example of that would be is like the tussle between the former Soviet Union and China. Like, I mean, Soviet Union had trusted China like anything. And then China, because of its territorial expansionist policy, had attacked Soviet Union, and there was a battle between Soviet Union, former Soviet Union, and China. So therefore, the experience of different countries have been very, very bad with China. I hope that the recent meetings between the External Affairs Minister of the Government of India as well as with the Chinese Foreign Minister, I think there was a talk of almost two and a half hours day before yesterday and yesterday, and I hope that some fruitful solution can be arrived at through this talk.
China's PLA continues to make incursion attempts at line of actual control in Ladakh. What is the intention?
They have this tendency of in their whole nefarious political expansionist policy, they have this tendency of trying to capture in Leh Ladakh, Jammu and Kashmir, as well as they do have their eyes on Himachal Pradesh, on Uttarakhand, Nepal, Bhutan, Sikkim, and Arunachal Pradesh as such, you know, and they all illegitimately claim that these are their territories as such, especially Arunachal Pradesh and Sikkim and this part of Leh Ladakh as such. So the recent fight between the Indian Army and the Chinese PLA in relation to the Ladakh thing only, whether it was in Galwan or whether it was in in the Chisul Valley, or whether in the recent skirmish which has taken place on the 29th and 30th of last month, you know, it is basically in relation to that expansionist doctrine of Mao Zedong as such. And I think Chinese PLA will keep on doing this nonsense, and they will keep on trying their misadventure. But I'm sure, and I'm absolutely, absolutely confident that the Indian Army will be giving them a befitting reply, like the way the Indian Army has given them in Galwan.
As when the world is suffering due to COVID-19 pandemic, China is blatantly violating border agreements. How do you see aggression by China with India?
COVID-19 was actually a kind of an instrument which China had spreaded out across the world. And many have said that the virus originated in Wuhan province of China as such, and which is to a great extent true. I myself, when this virus had originated way back in January, That time I had leveled this virus as one virus, and I had said that yes, it has originated from the animal market in Wuhan, as well as from the biological labs in Wuhan, where there is a secret mission of the Chinese army and the Chinese scientists to create in biological weapons to spread it across the world, whole world, and to, you know, go in for biological destruction as such. So having done that, having accomplished that mission, they now thought that now it is the best time to annex territories.
India has taken strong stand against China by putting trade restrictions and banning several mobile apps. Do you believe this is enough to counter Beijing for its behavior?
Almost around 200 applications, have been banned by the Indian government, by the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting Government of India. So I think almost around 200 apps have been banned. You know, like if as far as I understand, if it's not 200, then it should be somewhere between 150 to 200 as such. And in that, it includes in TikTok, Alibaba, and all these apps as such. Now, through all these apps, China used to take in a lot of foreign exchange of our country. You know, like, I mean, I was just looking into the estimates the other day in relation to the ban of TikTok as such, and after the ban of Alibaba and all those Chinese softwares. In the case of TikTok itself, in 3 days, China has lost almost around $2 million in 3 days' time. So you can imagine what is the level of losses of the Chinese business companies after the banning of all these apps as such.
Let's move to Afghanistan. While the Afghans have grown increasingly optimistic of the ongoing peace process between the Kabul establishment and the Taliban, the minorities, especially the Sikhs and Hindus, continue to flee the country owing to rising fundamentalist atrocities in the region. India, which is home to both the religions, has reacted by facilitating their relocation. Scores of Sikhs and Hindus have travelled New Delhi in last couple of weeks. Incidentally, India had last year amended its Citizenship Act, allowing persecuted minorities from its neighbourhood, including Afghanistan, to seek Indian citizenship.
A batch of over 150 Afghan Sikhs landed New Delhi on 3rd September. Latest in the series of persecuted Sikhs travelling India for safer environment and greener pastures. As many as 420 Afghan Sikh and Hindu families have come to India in just 2 weeks following extraordinary persecution. They say they suffered at the hands of Islamic radicals, including Taliban. While the radical cruelties targeting minorities they say were always widespread in Afghanistan, it was India's landmark Citizenship Amendment Act that provided them hope and motivation to leave the country. They are grateful to the Indian establishment.
Aaj 16 din ho gaye hame tere aaye.
Sir, jaise ki aap yahan pe aaye hain, kya
yahan pe kaun se halaat mein aapko yahan pe aana pada? Halaat to aisa hai ki bomb blast hua aur sab parivar chhai gaya. To sab kuch nahi reha. Jaidad wagaira sab chhota bhai, mummy sab chale gaye. To hum sab ko chhod ke aa gaye idhar. Hum in logon ka dhanyawad karte aur hamesha hamari khushi hai aur bhaiyon ki khushi aur rehne ki khushi hai bas.
Last year, India had come up with the act allowing persecuted religious minorities from its neighboring countries to seek Indian citizenship. Since then, a large number of foreign nationals who were living under refugee status in the country have been granted citizenship by New Delhi.
दो सौ परिवारों को अब तक दिल्ली से गुरुद्वारा मैनेजमेंट कमेटी लेके आई है इनके रहने का सहने का सब इंतजाम भी दिल्ली से गुरुद्वारा मैनेजमेंट कमेटी कर रही है। इनकी टिकट के पैसे भी जो हमारे साथ सहयोग दे रहे हैं विक्रमजीत सिंह सानी और अमेरिका की संस्थाएं, वो हमारा साथ दे रही हैं इसमें। इसी तरह इनके रहने के, इनके यहाँ दिल्ली में आके घर मिले इनको, इनका कारोबार हो, उसके लिए भी हमारे पास वेरियस एक संस्थाएं जो हमारा उसमें सहयोग कर रहे हैं और हम इनको किराए पे घर लेके दे रहे हैं।
Afghanistan, on the other side, has been constantly losing its minorities, with 95% of them vanishing in last half century. Victims say they were brutally targeted during the Mujahideen rule in 90s, and the situation only worsened after that. There was a brief reprieve in former President Hamid Karzai's initial administrative days, but violence returned as Taliban gradually gained ground. 26th March Kabul Gurudwara attack was a sharp reminder of how the fundamentalists haven't changed their stance even when there are growing talks about the peace process. While the Afghans, irrespective of their religious identities, have lived in harmony, it is the radical Islamists who have time and again carried out systematic drives against minorities. The United States Congress has described Afghan Hindus and Sikhs as endangered minorities and has even passed a resolution aimed at resettling them in America. But as of now, it is India which has been walking the talk. The government says it is committed to bring back all persecuted minorities from its neighbors. Whether it is war-torn Afghanistan or radical-driven, radical-governed Pakistan.
Moving on. Thousands of contract workers in Gilgit-Baltistan, a territory under illegal occupation of Pakistan, have launched a massive protest against the establishment demanding regularization of jobs. After years of struggle, the workers had managed to get the bill ensuring their permanency passed, but the bureaucracy, which comprises of the officers installed by Islamabad, have been barricading its implementation. Protesters have also threatened to intensify their movement to the extremes if their demands are not met immediately this time.
Around 6,000 contract and contingent employees serving in different departments of illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan recently staged a protest in front of the Chief Secretary office for the regularization of their jobs. Even though the Assembly has passed the Regularization of Contract and Contingent Employees Act 2020, and the Governor of Gilgit-Baltistan, Raja Jalal Hussain Makhboon, signed it on June 26, it has still not been implemented. The protesters demanded the immediate implementation of the Act, which should have been done around 2 months back.
हमारा मुतालबा ये है कि हमने यूनानिमसली, इस असम्बली ने इस बिल को पास किया, तकरीबन 2 महीने गुजर गए, अभी तक इस बिल पे इम्प्लीमेंटेशन क्यों नहीं हुई। ये जो आप देख रहे हैं इतनी बड़ी तादाद में, ये बेसिकली 6,000 नहीं, ये 36,000 लोग हैं। हर बंदे के पीछे एक फैमिली है, 6-6 बंदे, उस फैमिली को वो एक बंदा जो है उस फैमिली को की देखभाल कर रहा है। तो ये आप इनमें देखें, ज़्यादातर इम्प्लाईज़ की उम्रें भी गुजर चुकी हैं। कोई 50 में चल रहा है, कोई 49 में चल रहा है, कोई 55 में चल रहा है। 15-15 साल से ये अपने गिलगित बल्तिस्तान गवर्नमेंट को सर्व कर रहे हैं, लेकिन इनकी सुनवाई नहीं हो रही है। अब चूंकि एक भी आ गया, लॉ पास हो गया, अब उस लॉ को इम्प्लीमेंट करने में क्या मसला है। हम यहीं अपने हक के लिए आए हैं कि जी ये लॉ जो है, ये बिल जो है, फौरन इस पर इसको नाफिजुल अमल होना चाहिए और हमारे मुतालबात जो हैं उनको तस्लीम करना चाहिए।
Blaming the bureaucracy for their sufferings, the protesters said that it has been standing as a stumbling block in their way, but they will not step back and will continue their protest until their demands are fulfilled.
इस एक्ट के अमल दरामद कराने में वाजे तौर पर ब्यूरोक्रेसी रिकावट है,
हम इनके इन तखरी हरबों और इस तरह के ओछे हथकंडों की भरपूर मजम्मत करते हैं और अगर फौरी तौर पर इसको नाफिजुल अमल नहीं किया गया तो हम आखिरी हद तक जाएंगे। आखिरी हद से मुराद ये है कि हम हत्ता की ब्यूरोक्रेसी की इनखला का भी मुतालबा करेंगे जो हमारी हर तरह की आज़ादी और ख़ुद मुख्तारी में वाज़े तौर पर रिकावटें डाल रही है।
There are around 5,000 contingent employees who have been serving in Gilgit-Baltistan for many years at nominal salaries. Few employees are even paid rupees 1,000 monthly, which is also the violation of minimum wage law. Time and again, Gilgit-Baltistan government has made fake promises to regularize the contingent employees, but nothing has been done thus far.
Being an agrarian society, India celebrates a number of harvest festivals. These festivals are an integral part of the country's cultural legacy, and over the centuries they have evolved in various forms. So today, in our episode of South Asia Focus, we will take you to the eastern state of Odisha to witness Nuakhai festival, which was celebrated in a somber way amid the worldwide pandemic. Have a look.
Food is considered sacred in India. The country celebrates a variety of festivals to offer their prayers to gods for blessing them with a good harvest season and abundant produce. Nuakhai, observed in parts of western Odisha and southern Chhattisgarh, is one such festival that marks the new season of rice. Every year, the festival is celebrated with great pomp and show. But this year, due to the worldwide pandemic, the celebrations were kept a low-key affair, with citizens observing it at their homes instead of thronging the temples.
This time, the monsoon was kind enough. Right now, the things are going in the right direction. And due to this pandemic situation of COVID-19, though it has not been celebrated widely, but every household, they celebrate in their home, and it's the rich culture of our state.
Also known as Nabana and Nuakhai, in some parts of Odisha, the three-day festival is a symbol of gratitude towards the God for blessing the citizens with good rain, favorable weather, and lavish produce. Celebrated on the Panchami Tithi of Krishna Paksh of Bhadra month of Hindu calendar, preparations for the festival begins before a fortnight, which includes cleaning the house and buying new clothes. The festival breaks all caste and economic barriers and brings all citizens closer to each other as they all unite to celebrate the welcoming of new harvest.
Pavitra Nuakhai au ei dino samaste abala prada bhanita sokalu nitya karma sari sarvaprathame nijor jarjar kheto che samasto khetike jai kori ସମସ୍ତେ ନିଜ ଜମିରେ ପୂଜାପାଠ କରି କରି ନୂଆ ଧାନ ଆନି କରି ସମସ୍ତେ ଆଜ୍ଞା ଦିଅ ଦେବତାମାନଙ୍କୁ ଲଗେଇ କରି ତାପରେ ନୂଆଖାଇ ଯାଇସି।
ଆଜ୍ ଦ ୱାର୍ଡ ନୂଆ ମିନ୍ସ ନ୍ୟୁ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଖାଇ ମିନ୍ସ ଫୁଡ୍, ଦି ଫେଷ୍ଟିଭାଲ ନୂଆଖାଇ ରିଭଲ୍ଭସ୍ ଆରାଉଣ୍ଡ ଫୁଡ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦ ସେଲିବ୍ରେସନ୍ସ ଅଫ୍ ହେଲ୍ଦି ହାର୍ଭେଷ୍ଟ। It celebrates the farmer's possession of newly harvested rice. Devotees cook relishes from the first produce of the season, also which is served as a religious offering or prasad to the respective deities. It is further distributed to the entire family and is consumed by a priest. Various traditional dishes and sweets like rasbhara, suji mada, and kheeri are prepared on the occasion, and this year, because of the pandemic, families enjoyed the meals at their homes and took the blessings of the elders, priests and the Almighty. The festival has a big significance for farmers and agricultural community and also celebrates the renewal of mutual ties that spread warmth all around and binds the communities together in a spirit of solidarity.
The festival of Nuwakhai gives the present society a great message of the relevance of agriculture in the economic progress of the country. So with that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.